Would everyone please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance?
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Roll call, please. Mrs. Meltzer?
Thank you, Mr. Cannon. Both Trustee Matuzak and Trustee Patton are excused. Trustee Keys?
Here.
Supervisor Cannon?
Here.
Trustee Kress?
Present.
Treasurer Gilliham?
Here.
Clerk Meltzer here.
Thank you. We do have public comment cards in the front of the room with our police chief and in the back of the room. If you wish to speak after the items on the agenda are spoken to, you have that opportunity for 3 minutes. With that, we will approve the agenda.
So moved.
Support.
Roll call, please.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Trustee Keys?
Yes.
Hang on 1 second. Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Trustee Kress?
Yes.
Treasurer Gilliham?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. And with that, we'll take item one, approval of 3 early voting sites for the August primary and November general elections.
And Mr. Cannon, just to be clear, this is the reason why we're hosting this special meeting. Per election law that was passed in 2022, ballot proposal number 2, we are required to host early voting sites for the township. And I'll read the letter so that you can have a good understanding of exactly where and when we are going to have this. The Election Commission is asking to hold a special meeting on April 8th, 2024 at noon to ask the board to approve the resolution designating early voting sites and the associated fees to host for the August and November 2024 elections at the following locations: Faith Baptist Church, 34950 Little Mac Avenue, Kensington Church, 25000 Hall Road, and Clinton Township Civic Center, 40700 Romeo Plank Road. These locations meet the state of Michigan's requirement of placing early voting sites in line with diverse and increased voter access. Both population density as well as access to transportation were prioritized. The commitment by Kensington Church and First Baptist Church is huge, and we are very grateful for their collaboration to help us deliver democracy in our community. Please note the associated costs for early voting are paid for by reimbursement from state grant dollars. This commission looks forward to your approval. Sincerely, Kim Meltzer, Elections Commission Chair, and Tammy T. Patton, Elections Commission Member. And then also contained in the packet is the actual early voting resolution. I do want to make a quick amendment to the election. Do we have an attorney present today? What happened to our attorney? Are they?
He's in Florida.
Well, that's one of them, but there was supposed to be another one here. But anyway, I wanted just to make sure that the legal aspect was addressed. So on the early voting resolution, the third, whereas it says the early voting sites for state and federal elections will be open for 9 consecutive days, beginning the second Saturday before Election Day through the Sunday before Election Day during the hours of 8:30 a.m. to 4:30 p.m. That is going to need to be amended, and we can vote on this right now, to state that in for the locations at Kensington and Faith Baptist Church, the hours on Sunday will be from 2 p.m. to 10 p.m. And that is because that is so that we're not interfering with any church activities and so on. And just give an opportunity for voters that are late night voters or thinkers to participate. So those 2 Sundays, the hours for the early voting site will be from 2 p.m. to 10 p.m. So if that would be part of, that would be included in the motion.
Comments from the board?
Mr. Gannon?
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I guess I'll through the chair to the clerk. I'd ask, when is the deadline to make this decision?
Today. Well, it's not, I mean, the Bureau of Election wants it today, but we have to have these approved. I believe it's coming, it's before the final.
Yeah, I mean, I've become accustomed to you submitting things the day they're due, and
great.
I think that we're really, I've stressed this as many times as I could on the Election Commission, and now, you know, even as board member, I think it's unacceptable. I think that giving us the last minute You know, deadlines is not a good look for the township or for the board to make an educated decision.
Well, you can bring that up to the state of Michigan, because the state of Michigan has been the reason for the delays on all of these items that were being brought forward to you.
I'm not concerned with the state of Michigan. I'm concerned about my responsibility to be able to make a decision. You can't make this decision on your own, correct? Is the clerk able to decide that the locations are locations without a resolution of the board?
The Election Commission made the recommendation, right, and they're asking for this board.
Does the board
and
have
the meeting?
To?
Yes.
Okay, so
yes.
Again, I would like more time in making the decision. I know last time the senior center was used, and I was really, I was not supportive of the way we notified residents. It was very confusing. What is your plan this time around to notify residents of the different polling locations?
So we'll send out a postcard letting the voters know. So we are not utilizing the senior center for an early voting site for this August. And
so the brochures that we sent out that said that we were using the senior center for August and November, those are no longer correct?
Yeah. So they are correct. The issue was that it was for that election, the February election.
The issue is that you listed all three elections on there, February, August, and November.
That was to let them know that there are elections. Those are hosting elections. We are required by law, state law. It has to go out within.
Well, I just want my questions answered. I don't think we need to have it back and forth. I'm asking very specific questions.
It has to go out 60 days prior. It has to be, because we have to have our locations approved within 60 days of the election.
So
they wanted 120 days. Actually, they want 120 days notice. So the Bureau of Elections asked that if we could have it decided by today, that would be great.
So last time we had this board consider a budget amendment to pay for these postcards.
No, you didn't. Well,
yes, we did.
You only had to do that because it's getting reimbursed.
And
those
it was
costs
something
are reimbursed.
That was an add-on that we at the time requested more time. So I'm trying to map out when will the next time, will we need a budget amendment to pay for the postcards, and when will be the next time they go out? And you're telling me it'll be 60 days prior to the election.
The a minimum of 60 days. It can't be less than 60 days. But I'll send it out earlier because I want the public to have more time to.
What alternative locations were considered?
We looked at the church on Hayes. There's the St. Charbel Church on Hayes, which is a north end section. We divided it up into demographics. So we wanted to be able to make it fair for all voters. If they were wanting to utilize early voting, that they would be able to choose any of those three locations. So those tend to be a little bit spread out so that the public has easier access to it. It's closer proximity. So somebody that might have transportation issues would be able to utilize busing or any other ways that they need to be able to vote early. And early voting is just like election day voting. So it's important to a lot of people to have that option. Again, this is not a law I made. It is a law that the people of the state of Michigan created. And so I am, as an administrator, just administering these laws. This is not the rule according to Kim Meltzer. It is the law. And so my job as an administrator is to execute those requirements, and that's what I've done.
So the question to the answer is one church on Hayes.
There were no other locations I could do it. There was a big cost. So we looked at possibly Partridge Creek. Again, the issue of going with a private sector location would be that at any given time, they may not want us there because it's not financially a benefit to them. So we are trying to focus on areas that were nonprofit organizations or like schools and so on, but schools are not a good thing either. I tried the college, Macomb Community College, but because early voting only at this present time is run by local clerks versus a countywide, the college is not a good choice because many of the students, although they may be Clinton Township residents, many of those other students that come to Macomb Community College on Hall and Garfield are from outside of Clinton Township, and so they would see the opportunity to vote here, but they couldn't. So it's just not, this law that went into place really isn't designed to best serve the public at a local run office, but that's the way it is. So, so we are implementing it. So we looked at the college, we looked at private sector, and we looked at another church to try to kind of spread those demographics out. And we feel we did accomplish that. So Kensington Church takes care of the north end of the community. Clinton Township, the center, our center campus takes care of that. And then at the south end, Faith Baptist Church. So we think that that's a really good display of democratic consideration for the voters.
And just to make sure another example doesn't fall out of the sky here, you said Partridge Creek, the church, and the college. Those are the three that you looked at as alternatives.
We did.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And then what efforts are we taking? I know we have contracts with these churches. What efforts are we taking to mitigate the potential bias that the locations create?
There will not, it's the same as any other precinct. There will not be biases allowed. Like there won't be polling people. There'll still be the 100-foot radius. So it is a precinct. So it will be treated as such. So
you've been a clerk for a really long time. And so understanding, even just, you know, I was able to jump on Google and see the numerous studies by Stanford most recently to show that there is a bias in hosting a polling location in a church because there are people that carry a bias against or for churches. So, I mean, even the most recent study that I was just able to pull up mm-hmm. from Stanford shows that people that do vote in a church are more likely to vote for certain issues versus other issues. And by being in a room full of crucifixes and walking into, you know, a voting location that implies some of these issues, it can create a bias. And so that's why I think it's important that when we are going to use a location, just like you said, they have priorities, they have church services, they have different things that they, you know, want to accomplish, mm-hmm. that we are protecting our residents who are going to have to go in there and vote. I can tell you personally, as somebody who grew up going to St. Thecla Church, I've talked with many of my past students that attended that school, and we get together and speak, and there's a huge collection of people that are not comfortable going to certain churches or being a part of certain churches. There's a lot of people here in Clinton Township that feel that their church has maybe forgotten them or left them, rightly or wrongly, and that can cause them stress or anxiety in having to choose to vote at a church. And so I think there's things that we can do, certainly, to prevent that bias from coming forward.
Go ahead, tell me how you would do that.
So you haven't considered that at all?
So, in fact, I have.
Okay, so can you walk
you
us through that?
You have this tinge of disrespect as always. But those are things I definitely have considered. Some would say that your position you don't seem to care that could be the case when we host elections at schools. And that there's,
What do you mean by that?
Well, there's a bias. Could there be a bias by hosting an election in a school, especially when there's a millage on the ballot? So, but I don't hear you talking an objection to that. I mean, that May 7th is going to be, we're going to have a Clintondale schools as well as the Lance Crew schools for the school elections. That's actually for the benefit of the schools. Yet you're not objecting to that.
No, I haven't had people share heartful testimony with me that why they're afraid to go.
I'm sure people are looking out.
I'll let you finish.
To
let
you
her
for
finish.
Heartfelt conversations. However, I did. So, for instance, at Kensington Church, there, speaking of crucifix, there is a large crucifix in the room that we're hosting, and I asked, could they please remove that? There can be no influence that way. When you go into the Kensington Church, we are not in near the congregation portion of it. We're off to a room to the side that has easy access from the parking lot, and it goes right into the church and goes off to the left. Kensington Church doesn't even look like your traditional church, right? In terms of, there's no steeple, there's none of any of that. So when you walk into that church, it isn't a glaring, crucifix, or there's nothing like that. But off to the side, there was a room that we are going to utilize for early voting, and it's a prayer room, and it did have a crucifix in it, and two of them, and one had a picture, and I said, can you please remove anything? And I felt awkward even asking that, because, it's the house of God, and
that
whatever.
Shows the bias, right?
Yeah.
you feel like someone's watching you, like you're...
No, I'm not watching. Well... No, that isn't it. It's just simply that, you know, we're in the house of, you know, somebody else's home, right? The church or the school. And we always try to be respectful. And so I was just simply saying that has to be up. And they agreed. They were very not at all bothered by that. In terms of Faith Baptist Church, which is going to be, the entrance is going to be actually on the side of the, which is an old Baker College, which doesn't really look like a church at all again. So I thought these locations were actually an unbiased presentation and really served as a great opportunity because they have the parking, they have the large location. And so both of these churches were very open to receiving the opportunity to help us deliver democracy. And I think they're great locations. And I do hope I get support on this board because this is a greater access to the voters by allowing these locations where they're at. And it is required by our Constitution. Our state law now requires that.
Mr. Cannon, just to close, I'm happy to find that there was something that said to either the election commission or to you that, you know, we can't just go into any church. We have to be mindful that there is a bias. And you said so just yourself in trying to remove crucifixes or trying in my reading of the agreement, none of that's in there. So it sounds like there are concerns that you have, but we're not hearing them and we're not being reassured that they're not going to be.
I just reassured you. But I just did.
And so you're saying right now that there are. We can amend this agreement that there'd be no crucifixes.
Yeah, sure. Okay. You can do so, that. Is there anybody here from Kensington or Faith Baptist Church? Okay.
But again, I think that would be important. I think we need to build in protections within agreement to protect voters. I'm disappointed that we didn't consider the South Branch Library, any of the vacant spots on Grosbeck.
I did. I did consider the libraries, but they were available.
You got a new one.
Yeah, libraries. They're not available.
So again, I think that we need to have a more public conversation about this. We stress that we did not want a last minute decision the last time we did this. I guess just to close out my last question, when was the election commission meeting that this was recommended?
The 5th. So just keep in mind, everybody's on vacation. You guys are all on vacation. So I couldn't host this any earlier. I had to have a quorum. You know, everybody took on a vacation. You just got back.
This state law was passed in 2022, correct?
The implementation of all of the ask of Proposition 2 took years to put into place. There has to be, and I know it's for this, people that don't understand how a process works, but when legislation passes, like Proposition 2, there has to be a way to implement those asks. That took the legislature almost 2 years to make happen. In fact, when we had, and I'm going to do a report for a resident that has asked for this, that even the electronic poll book, which is what we use to record voters as they come through on election day, we got the change of process on the Friday before election day. So I have to train approximately 400 election workers, and all of them come with socioeconomic background differences, education differences, the ability to process all of the information that they have to know to execute elections is enormous. And so the state gives us this new process the Friday before a presidential primary and expects me to be able to train them and not only find the time to train them, but them to understand the process. And so it is a huge change. I want the public to know that Proposition 2 of 2022 voted in by the voters of Michigan at about 60-some% rate. And it is a huge undertaking to implement all those changes. So that's what the Bureau of Elections is doing. And then we wait on the clerks or the Bureau of Elections to give us that information, and then we have to implement it and train on it and so on. So we did, in terms of early voting, if I can toot my own horn, which I think I need to because there's so much doubt, is the early voting went off fabulously. And I'm really grateful to the state for their training on that. And although there was that little glitch, which. But overall, we did great to implement that new process. Any new process is going to have challenges. So I am grateful for that. And I think we're on the right path in approving this resolution. I can certainly, if you want to have a say in what you think a bias is, but I have taken care of that. I have addressed that. But we can certainly add it in the resolution that no crosses in a Christian church would be visible to the voter as a form of influence.
Thank you. Sir?
And I am disappointed, right, but I want to say something really quick, that we don't have an attorney here today for this board meeting.
He's in Florida.
Well, he's in Florida, but he has another attorney, Linda McGrail, and she's
I agree with you, sir.
He lives in Florida. Most people don't realize that.
And that's why I voted not to have him as our attorney.
Yep. Sam Bushell, 18546 Wayland Drive. On this, there again, as the clerk stated, the state wanted 120 days, but the clerks thought that was bad, so they wanted 60 days. Well, if I go back to the August primary, we're 120 days from that. And so all of a sudden, this is going to be something that we have to demand on a special meeting in the middle of the afternoon on Eclipse Day. And I would point out that I was here at the meetings before the presidential primary, where many of the people on the board and all the people in the audience specifically did not want this to be held at churches. In fact, we mentioned that, you know, we've got a bunch of public buildings that we pay the taxes for. And it's a matter of the clerk was the one that wanted her location was the churches. She liked that. And I think by putting this down to say it's got to be done today, it doesn't give this board much of a chance to honor what the citizens had said at the time. We don't want this in churches. And I went to Catholic school, and I've got a sister that's a nun for 60 years. I'm not against churches, but it's not the place to vote. We have a bunch of public buildings, and I believe this really was a passive aggressive move by the clerk to have this and say it's gotta be done today, which I've seen that a couple times, and a special meeting is not called for. I think that the board has to look at this, and I guess I'm literally going to have to FOIA the different public institutions around here and see which ones now, if the libraries were approached about this and they couldn't do it. I really want to find out from them if they actually were approached.
Yeah, talk to Larry Neal. He's the director.
I'll FOIA it because that's the easiest way. And so I just think it's a matter of the public was very clear. You don't want to, you got a separation of church and state. And there is just no reason at all to have an election when we have all these public buildings we pay for.
Which ones would you like me to host it in?
Kim, let him finish.
Okay.
We have all these public buildings, including schools, the libraries. There again, the offices here. You got the senior center. There has to be a whole bunch of, and there again, everybody votes at schools all the time. They're used to that. They're public buildings that we pay for. And I think it's just wrong. I think it's very wrong to have a special meeting for something that should have been. The clerk did not want to have extra polling places for the primary. And then all of a sudden, she had a whole bunch of months. That's several months ago. This could have been on a regular meeting a long time ago. And to meet the 60-day rule that now the state applies, you got another couple months, people, to look at this. I think you should all vote no. Thank you.
Thank you. I certainly respect your opinion to disagree with it. I disagree with almost everything you said, however. Sir, you have the floor.
Mr. Cannon, really quick, if I can just say, presently we do have our elections at two churches that we've had for at least 50 years now. We've had them, and nobody's ever said had a problem with having our elections at Trinity Lutheran Church or on Hayes or Harper, and then there's one on Hayes. So I don't know where this is coming from, and nor do I ever recall anybody from the public saying, we don't want you to look at churches for early voting sites. That's
Mrs.
never.
Mrs. Meltzer?
I don't recall.
It's called a red herring.
Yeah.
Sir, you have the floor.
My name is Paul Schorsch, and I live at 38057 Moravian Drive. And I got to tell you guys, after the theft of the 2020 election, all these new laws and all this stuff going on, I'm gonna tell you something, man. Clinton Township better do the right thing here. There ain't nothing wrong with voting at schools, not a damn thing, all right? And as far as I'm concerned, the state of Michigan, all these new rules, all these new laws, I don't really think the people actually voted for that. All right. And I'm standing here right here. And I'm thinking Clinton Township. I love this township. I've lived here for since like 1999. I built my house here on the corner of James and Moravian, the American dream. And it wasn't free. I came here, paid for every frickin' permit to do it. All right. And my family built the house. They all pitched in and they did it. You know, my kids, my wife. All right. And I love this township. And as far as I'm concerned, voting at the schools, there's nothing wrong with that. I think we should stick with that.
Okay, a lot of the schools don't want people coming while their students are there, so they would have to cancel school.
Yeah, for 9 days.
I have in the back, and then here, and then there.
That's not the law.
Fred Neenstead, 41362 Justin Drive, Clinton Township. Supervisor Cannon and a board. I would like to remind everyone that at the one location I've been to, Faith Baptist, there is no cross possibly visible in the room that I would expect them to have the voting in.
That's correct.
There's a foyer, then you walk in and you go to the room and you turn around and walk out. There is absolutely no church-related functions occurring in the, let's say, 25 feet of open space between the voting precinct area and the open door to the outside. So if I were to complain about the site, it would be that there are parking spaces available within the 100-foot range that I would not have access to if I were sitting on the pole pursuing a particular agenda for a candidate or an issue. Also, I'd like to remind the board that proposal was passed for the early voting with 15 days of consideration after the proposal was finalized. The first ballots went out in the mail for this statewide proposal with 15 days for the opposition to manage a rebuttal. I filed a lawsuit against the Secretary of State to repeal or somehow rescind this unilateral approach of changing our Constitution. I wanted the long version of the proposal sent with the mail-in ballots. We have two classes of voters today, a class of voters that is getting it by mail and a class of voters that is getting it in person. When you walk in person, it's law that it be on the wall. There is no compensation for that fact for mail voting. It is unconstitutional. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, board. Dana Duggar, 37852 Suburban in the beautiful southeast central portion of our township. We are very fortunate that we do not have the building of the Supreme Court of the United States within our township, and we are considering it for a voting site. I believe the facade of that building has a lot of biblical references on it. A lot of our federal buildings, our state buildings, have references to the biblical references. And if people are opposed to that, our forefathers were not. And if people are going to take offense for having to traverse a building that has biblical references, what about the references that we have to traverse that have other items regarding the woke agenda and the other agendas that are out there? If we're going to ask churches to remove any references to God, Jesus, the cross, any of that, let's make sure that we have any other secular objects removed that may be offensive to anyone, that we have rooms that are sterile and vacant, that we have none of that. We must stop the blatant attacks on Christianity in this country, and we must stop it now. Look at the facade of the Supreme Court and understand the founding of our country. I thank you for your time.
Thank you. Sir?
Hello, my name is John Parkinson. I'm a Cone Township resident. We know that Proposition 2 is law.
Can we get your address, please?
It's not necessary. I don't have to put it on record.
No, you don't, but we'd like it if you...
I'd really not give it out.
You're from Macomb Township?
I am from Macomb Township.
Okay. Thank you.
I'll give you that much. So, hello, board. While we understand that Proposal 2 was law, it is my opinion that it is an unjust law, and it was passed to cheat, steal. And the Bible says, thou shall not steal. But we know what happens with early voting and mail-in voting and all that good jazz. So we went through the 2020 election together. As for the crucifix removal, as a Christian, I'm deeply saddened we would even consider the removal of such. Our country was founded on Christianity. In fact, our forefathers prayed before every meeting. I hope you guys are aware of that. The other thing, somebody brought up separation of church and state. That is the most inaccurately used statement today. The separation clause was put in there so that no state could force a citizen to study or believe in one religion. So I want you guys to understand that when you guys use separation of state, you guys keep using it so unjustly, it sickens me. Okay, it was there so that no government could force, say, Islam on me or Catholicism on me. I can choose my religion. The separation of church and state, in fact, the clause is not even in the Constitution. It was just there. Okay, so there's other issues along with your elections that I would implore you guys to look at. Currently, there's legislation in the state to ban firearms at polling locations within 100 feet of polling locations. We're fighting that. We're fighting that on the state level, and I know you guys don't have any control over that. But I want you to let you know when you put a polling location at a church. That church must understand that that becomes a public building and that open carry is allowed per preemption law in Michigan, okay, with a valid CPL, okay? I'm a firearms instructor. I'm a member of Michigan Open Carry Incorporated. I'm a very staunch gun advocate. So when you guys put these locations at churches, which I am not opposed to at all, you need to make the churches aware that they became a public domain for voting and that all applicable laws apply. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
That's a scary thought. John Grossmeyer, 18402 Searland Drive. Everybody pretty much said all they want. I support, you know, putting, I appreciate, I'll respect Mr. Keys here, but people get offended by a cross. To me is like a ridiculous even argument. I'm for pushing this and voting for it because, you know, they all said what they thought and I just agree with it. I'm okay with it. So, you know, don't waste your time on this. Let's just push it.
Thank you. We've had people who are opposed to these sites, but I can tell you this. I know that Mrs. Meltzer has worked very hard, not only on this election, but on others to make sure we have polling sites that are fair for all who live in the community. All the public buildings aren't available. The college wasn't available. I mean, the schools would have to cancel school at the locations if we were to use schools. They don't want people coming from the outside into the buildings with students in the classroom or in the hallways. That's just a fact of life. And you know that most of the time on the main voting day, mm-hmm. schools are out of session. They have teacher and service days to keep the kids safe. There's a lot of reasons for that. And I know that she was very specific about trying to make sure there were geographic areas. As far as things in a room, if you're offended, vote on voting day or vote absentee. There's a lot of options. You don't have to pick one of these three spots. And we can't, as a board, decide state law. We can criticize, as some have, and you're welcome to do that. You know, that's one of the great things about our society is you get to criticize and nobody's going to hurt you for it. They might criticize you for it, But that's just the way we operate. And even though there's some of you I agreed with, some of you I disagreed with, that's fine. That's what this country is all about. Now we have something on the floor, and I'm going to make a motion that we approve for 3 voting sites for election days coming up, for the pre-election days. Or what is the term you use, Mrs. Meltzer?
This is 3 early voting sites.
Pre early voting. It's something new. It's been very difficult for not only Mrs. Meltzer, but for other clerks throughout the state and throughout the county. It's something new, different, and hard. And she has a lot of people she has to train. So with that, my motion is to approve these sites. Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Roll call, please.
Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Trustee Kress?
Yes.
Trustee Keys?
No.
Treasurer Gilliham?
No.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
So the motion passes. Those will be the 3 voting sites.
Thank you.
Item 2 on the agenda. Introduction of Ordinance Repealing Chapter 266, the Local Officials Compensation Commission.
Mr. Cannon, I can speak to this?
Okay.
Absolutely. This item is being introduced for consideration at our next meeting. It's to dissolve the Compensation Commission. I voted against the creation of this commission and have voted against every appointment to the commission since being elected in 2016. Compensation commissions are inherently less transparent and less accountable. The commission's recommendations for pay raises are never required to come and be voted on by this board. Instead, the commission's determinations are automatic unless a 2/3 majority of this board rejects the commission's decision. Others on this board, including Chair Cannon, publicly stated during the most recent appointment to this commission that they would support exploring the dissolution of the commission to increase transparency and regain the fiduciary responsibilities we're tasked with. Repealing this ordinance would restore the direct accountability of elected officials in determining compensation and align with the principles of transparency and democratic governance. And so with that, I'll make the motion to introduce.
Is there a second?
Support.
Yes, sir.
Again, Dana Duggar, 37852 Suburban. I don't know what the urgency of adding this into this special meeting was, other than that it sets it up to allow it to be voted on in the next regularly scheduled meeting in 7 days or less. And I tried to read through Public Act 359 regarding this, and there seemed to be some language that, again, it'd be helpful to have an attorney here, that reverts, if you do not have this commission, that reverts you back to like a per diem fee. And there's a lot in Public Act 359 that I, as a layman, do not understand, and I would hope that this is researched thoroughly, and that Public Act 359 in 1947 that sets a lot of rules for how townships operate, and I just do not see the urgency of the dissolution of this ordinance. This ordinance was passed in July 24th, 2017. With only one dissenting vote, that being Mr. Keys. And I'm just curious as to, we have different board members now. I think the only other two are the chair and, well, there's three. The chair, Mr. Gilliam, and Ms. Meltzer were present then. But I would just like to hear more about this and the why it needs to be, and what would we revert to in determining compensation for elected. And again, 359, don't understand, it talks about trustees in one section. I tried to find where 359 speaks to the supervisor, the treasurer, and the clerk. Again, a layman, I could not find that, but I would just hope that we have more discussion and more information forthcoming on this before it is eligible to be brought to a vote at the next session, and I would encourage you to table this and let there be more research and people be more educated as to what the new procedure would be. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I will be voting no on this. Yes, sir.
Yes, it's a matter of, I think most people in the township don't realize this committee is people that are appointed by the board. And I know that the board, when they get a recommendations for appointments, it is strictly Mr. Cannon. And then the board can vote on them. They become all of the board's appointees just because they voted on them. But in the past, I mean, this board has actually, even for like the Planning Commission, has decided that they would have somebody from Oakland County be on our Planning Commission rather than a citizen of the township when they had multiple applications from the township. And in this case, with this particular committee, they make their decisions. And once they set it up, if the board does nothing, they just get the raises and the compensation packages that this committee came up with. Two-thirds of the board has to vote no to stop these raises that are set up by a committee appointed by the receivers of the raises. I think that the board should have the courage to do this on their own, literally. Come up with the fact. And there again, as the Macomb Daily pointed out today, part of this is the fact that, you know, over in Harrison Township, their three top elected officials, based on one of these committees, just in the past few weeks, by not voting no, they got $95,000 a year each. And I think this is a good idea to get rid of this committee, have your open meetings. You know, a lot of stuff in this township has been being done administratively out of the sight of the citizens. And I think it's really time to stop that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
If I could just answer one of the speakers, Mr. Duggar had asked about the urgency. I just want to speak to that. I don't feel that there's urgency. I think it's timely. I think that at our next meeting, right now we have posted posting for this commission. So we're asking residents to consider sitting on this commission and putting in the work to come up with a compensation recommendation. And so getting ahead of that, trying to submit this for discussion, again, recognizing that today we're just introducing the ordinance. It'll be at the next meeting where we actually discuss it, vote on it, possibly table it. This is the introduction of that. And I think it's really important to answer the big question that Mr. Duggar asked is, what happens if this passes? And what do we revert back to? We revert back to this board having to determine our compensation instead of a commission of appointed members that meet in a separate room outside of this meeting and make a recommendation. That's the first thing. So we return accountability back to us. We make the decision. The second thing is we remove the arbitrary two-third threshold needed to reject a pay raise. So currently with this ordinance, if we wanted to reject a pay raise, we need two-thirds majority of this board. Why would we not just need a simple majority? And so by removing this ordinance, we do two things. We restore accountability and transparency by bringing it back to this board and not an appointed group of individuals in the back room, and we make sure that it's transparent by bringing it here and voting on it in front of the public. So I just wanted to answer those two things.
Okay. Since this commission has been in effect, there has been one very modest pay increase for the full-time officials.
Mr. Cannon, point of clarification.
There's been two.
Two? Mm-hmm. Very modest.
Yeah.
Very
point
modest.
Of clarification, do you remember how you voted on those?
I voted in favor.
No, only on one. The other one, we didn't even vote on. It went into effect automatically.
There have been three.
Right.
There have been three.
There have been four.
Four total.
Yeah. Four. Yeah. Yeah.
Four. See, votes. And that's my point, is instead of us
your
knowing
point is
it,
that you don't know.
Instead of the business coming before this committee and the agendas being posted on the website, you have to go through Laserfiche and only get the minutes of their meeting, none of the backup material. And so the threshold for transparency is much lower for this group than is our own board.
Okay.
Mr. Kim.
I'll give you the floor in 1 second. You're next. I had no backup material for this add on to this agenda because I thought we were only going to be voting for the locations that we had to for the clerk's office.
What about the third agenda item?
I'm not talking about the third. Oh, okay. I'm talking about this item. I too, like Mr. Duggar, feel that this is being rushed, and I don't like being rushed, which is why I'm going to vote no.
Okay,
sir.
The makeup of the Compensation Commission is it, and I'm going to address the chair and this question to you. Do you object to the makeup of it? The persons? Do we need more people? Do we? What is it? Rather than change it, I mean, from what I understand, the Compensation Commission, the members are citizens, residents of Clinton Township. And premise, I love the fact that they have a say-so and pay increases and that sort of thing. But the way you're talking, once again, I'm talking through the chair to you, is that it's dysfunctional in some way. Is there a way we can increase the number of persons on there, the makeup of it, rather than dispose of it?
I appreciate the question, Trustee Kress. I do think, though, that my issue with the Compensation Commission is not the makeup or the individual members, but it is the idea that we should be passing the buck on the decision of how much elected officials make. We are the fiduciary responsibility for this township. We make all of the fiduciary decisions. And so there's no other decision that we say to a committee, please decide for us. And we, you know, mind you, when you make a decision, don't even bring it back to this board for us to vote on. Just contact our HR department and it'll go into effect automatically. The buck should stop with us. The votes, just like we've talked about, we have people say we've had three recommendations, we've had four recommendations. We've had some recommendations that we voted on, others that have gone into effect automatically because there was no one here to vote on them. And so we need to restore the accountability portion, not the fact that the committee is dysfunctional.
Isn't the accountability part how the board votes upon based on their recommendation?
But the board does not have to vote on their recommendation. The recommendation goes into effect automatically.
Okay. Is that something we can change in the Compensation Commission?
No, that's the state law. The politicians built this law so that way they can create compensation commissions, have the commission recommend a pay raise, and then claim there's all these thresholds.
Well, the other side of the coin is we determine our own raises, and I'm totally against that.
See, I think that's where we would disagree. I think that we should be accountable. I don't think anyone else should be accountable. I don't know if you're even able, I know I'm not, to name the members of the Compensation Commission, or even when they last met, or when they'll be meeting next. Yep. I don't think any members of the public even understand what a Compensation Commission is, but they know who we are. We're accountable to them.
Yeah. The nomination.
Excuse me, sir. You don't speak from the audience. Yes, sir.
Mr. Cannon. Just so you know, I've been trying to speak even before the public so that they had a better understanding of how this whole thing transpired. But
You brought it forward. So, yes, go ahead.
No, I did not bring this forward.
No, not today.
Yeah, this agenda item, I didn't.
We had trouble getting the board to vote on compensation for elected officials.
Yeah.
And, I mean, everybody can go back and say what they said whenever. However, this is at a very late date prior to people having to file for election soon. And I guess I'm with what you said, that this is being pushed too fast, too quick. Mrs. Meltzer?
Thank you, Mr. Supervisor. So I want to give a history of how this whole thing evolved. I was elected in 2012. And when I got elected, none of those positions, there was even, it had been some time since the board had gotten a raise. And Supervisor Cannon said that this is an issue that we have to address. And I said, you know, I agree with you on one point, but on the other hand, I am not comfortable voting myself a raise. It's just not, I'm never gonna do it. So we didn't do anything about it. And then our treasurer came to us, our present treasurer, now at the time, I don't know if you were treasurer, I don't think you were, came to us and said that, you came from the county, take the position. Yeah, maybe you were treasurer at the time. And you had to take a pay cut. And that you had two girls that were gonna go into college and you needed, this
what
to be addressed.
What information, Mr. Cannon?
Just a minute,
no,
I'm talking.
No, I mean, we're gonna bring up people's families and
no,
you're
we're
just,
not bringing up a family.
I wanna make sure what you're saying is accurate.
Let her finish, please.
Let me get to the point.
Please.
So I said, okay, you know what, I get it. Yes, this does need to be addressed. I mean, it's been a long time, many years at the time that the board didn't. And when I say the board, it's the position that needs to be compensated, not the person, right? So I see the value in that. And I said, okay, you know what, fine, I'll be a team player. And if you guys want to bring this forward, you know, I'll support it on one condition, that every single person also supports it.
Because that's a violation of the Open Meetings Act.
If one person doesn't, guess what happens? Guess what happens? Well, that was a conversation I had with Mr. Gillum, which it was one person, not with you. But
so
I
can clarify, you had a conversation with one board member where you wanted to ensure all yes votes before you voted.
No.
Would you stop it? You're like, you're so doggone immature.
Oh my God.
Wow.
You're like the teenage, the kids in the grade school. You don't let her finish. Let her finish.
Well, it's
you will have your opportunity to say what you want. I've given you all that opportunity. But please don't interrupt her.
Thank God this poll was here, otherwise I would have gotten hit right in the face.
Good. I'm glad the poll was there.
Yes.
That's,
so anyway, but do you see how unfair you guys are? You interrupt, you don't let us speak. So anyway, let me continue. So this is, I want to share the evolution of how we created a compensation commission. Because we couldn't, because of the politicalness on this board, we couldn't really come up with, representing accountability for compensation for the positions. When we did finally make the, put it on the agenda, I explained that as long as everybody would support it, I would be fine with supporting it as well. Because if you don't, what happens is they will use that against you in a campaign, use it politically. And so the politics I was trying to take out of this whole situation. So the board came, they voted, and some members didn't support it. So I didn't support it either. I said, okay, fine, we don't have the support. So then after that, that's when I said, let's create a compensation commission. As a former state representative, I know that the compensation exists at the state level, and it also exists at many other jurisdictions. And this takes the politics out of the pay increases. So it consists of people in our community, and they make that, they do the research, they can only meet once every 2 years. And they live in this township. They're generally aware of what's going on in the community. So they are more qualified to give their input. And when, just so you know, when Mr. Keyes talks about, well, oh, you don't know this or you don't know that, most people don't know because that's not what they do. He doesn't know a lot of things that go on, but it's not because he's stupid or because he's unaccountable. It's just you can't know everything, so you have to do your research. So that's what these people were really assigned to do, is to do the research on whether or not this board has served the public. And I like that scenario. I think that is transparent. His statement about this not being transparent is totally inaccurate from my perspective. I think it is very, those meetings are open. You can attend them like there are any other meetings. And I encourage you to do so. But again, they only meet once every 2 years. And that's when it's decided. Now, the first recommendation by the Compensation Commission, they tried to build it up at a substantial amount. It was like a 16% increase for the supervisor, a 12%, and maybe 5% for trustees. I don't remember the exact percentages. But it was a little higher than what, I guess we were comfortable because we voted it down. So that's kind of the evolution. That's how the Compensation Commission started. It was to take the politics out of getting elected. Now, I want you also to know that Clinton Township, our full-time elected officials are the lowest paid in the state. However, the trustees, they're the highest paid. And so Mr. Keyes gets the highest paid as a trustee with incredible benefits, and us three that are here full-time get the lowest paid. Now, it's my understanding, I heard it through the grapevine, but I'm going to share it with you, that Mr. Keyes is planning on running for one of these full-time positions. But he doesn't want to work for the lowest paid opportunity. He wants the highest. And so he sat down in my office and gave me this document. It's a resolution. And I told him, I said, Mike, I appreciate you wanting to address this issue because you've been a no all this time. I don't know why. At the time, I hadn't thought of it because he just walked in my office unannounced and said he wanted to change and get rid of the Compensation Commission. And in its place, he was going to introduce a 34% increase in pay.
And so again, we get to just make things up.
Excuse me, Mr. Keyes, you did that.
No, let's see what she has in her hand. I'd love to see it.
And you gave me one. You came to my office too. Same thing.
Again, this is a resolution.
Please, let her finish.
Let me finish. You can address it after. But this is a resolution that after it's introduced, then it goes to the board meeting on the 15th, and then the then we can vote to approve it. But there's zero transparency by him because this wasn't put in the packet today. This is just what he gave me. He's not letting the public know that his plans are to introduce a huge increase. And so putting a compensation commission agenda item or a payment or pay increase item on the agenda, on a special agenda, in the middle of the day is very non-transparent and very wrong. And I told him also that there is no way I would support this unless the entire board was here, because the entire board needs to be accountable for their own compensation, if that's the case. So I'm very disappointed that Mr. Keyes raises his hand and talks about transparency and talks about accountability, but when it comes to him, he's nowhere accountable or transparent. And in fact, he also emailed this to me using Google Docs, which is not our email system. So he used his private system. And then when I went to pull it up, thanks goodness I copied it, because I know the person I'm dealing with. So I did copy this when he first emailed it to me. Because when I tried to retrieve it again, it was gone and he denied me access. Now, this is information that you as the public have a right to. But when he uses his own personal email and he can take out pertinent information in a conversation, this I think is a violation of the Open Meetings Act, number one. And number two, it's very unaccountable and wrong. And so this is a ploy, in my opinion, for him to make sure now all of a sudden he wants to make sure there's compensation because he wants to run for one of the full-time positions. And that's why he wants to be compensated, because right now we're the lowest compensated in the state of Michigan, but he is the highest compensated for his position. Okay, those were the clarifications. If there's any questions, I can answer those.
Well, we have two members of the community and Mr. Keyes.
If I could clarify, my name was brought up. I was accused of asking for pay raises. I mean, I think I should be able to respond.
And you are to respond, but not to interrupt another board member, which is what you kept doing.
Is it time to respond?
Finally, it is, yes, Mr. Keyes.
Thank you.
Finally.
So what I want to make sure the public understands is, again, we just had this. We had someone who wanted to be on the Compensation Commission. They came before us and asked to be appointed. I voted no. Mr. Cannon asked Mr. Keyes, why do you keep voting no? You never explain yourself. So I explained myself. I said, I don't believe that we should have a compensation commission. Instead, we should have a resolution that comes before this board on an annual basis to set the pay of the elected officials for the next term that is comparable with the raises that go into effect for the union employees. The resolution that Ms. Meltzer is waving around is a draft resolution that would not be even coming up at this meeting or the next meeting. It would come up at a future meeting where we would discuss that compensation. Again, I've told this room and the public, restoring accountability. Now you would see how we're coming to the decision of the pay increases or the lack thereof. I'm sure we can probably put that resolution around. You'll notice that in the spot where it says pay increases, there's an asterisk that says these increases are for conversation purposes only and are not what I am submitting. So again, Ms. Meltzer and apparently Mr. Cannon like to take advantage of the fact that they hold the paper and the cards and can say to the public, here, this is what I have. You can't see it, but I am being transparent with you. I was transparent from the very beginning when I voted no on the Compensation Commission, voted no on all the appointments, and at our most recent meeting when we appointed a compensation member and I voted no, I said I would not only be bringing this forward, the ordinance to dissolve the Compensation Commission, but I also said I would be bringing the resolution that Ms. Meltzer is referring to at a future meeting, which says that the pay raises will be the same as the union employees. That's what we need to get to here in Clinton Township, is that the pay, we will vote on the pay for the next term okay? Never voting for our own pay increases.
But you would if you were elected.
Meltzer, let him finish.
Obviously, someone needs to run for the full-time positions. That's what I've learned in this experience, that we really need more professionalism and accountability. And so I want the public to know that if this does pass, the dissolvement of the Compensation Commission in the future, I would bring a resolution to this board meeting where we talk about this instead of the Compensation Commission meeting once every odd number year. People you don't even know, you haven't identified, we can barely name or say when they're meeting. Instead, you'll come to this meeting. Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Cannon.
I have two members of the community. You were first. And Dana, you were second. And then we were going to vote.
Supervisor Cannon, Fred Neenstead, 41362 Justin Drive. Obviously, this is a passionate example of politics in our local community. Certainly, a just compensation is required. It seems inappropriate, the different pay levels as far as priority. So a commission is a volunteer member, is that assumption?
Yes.
They are volunteer mm-hmm. members of
yes.
the community, they're mm-hmm. respected, so they're chosen carefully, right? Everybody has a choice. So if you don't like a member who's been appointed or recommended, that there can be a denial, right? So also, when the value of any increase is proposed, it is done in an open meeting, right? So how's that?
No? Correct.
It is correct, yes. So why would we suspect that there's somehow something wrong with it, right? On the face of it, I have to say that there must be transparency, and that would be an open meeting. And do any of the trustees here attend those commission hearings?
I don't believe so.
No.
So that's a question, you know. So they have a chance to have an effect on the result by actually publicly stating their position at an open meeting. This is something I would feel takes the politics out of it. It sort of transposes the position, right? Makes them a requester of this. So why is it that we have to have 2/3 to overturn the commission's result, right?
That's by state statute.
So it is possible for the ordinance to be added, I believe, that would modify that. I may be wrong, I'm not a lawyer, but if there was a way to modify that, to make it a majority, obviously it would introduce politics, but it would balance the independent nature of a commission versus the public's right to know. So we would focus a noteworthy event where the public would be watching. Well, so we would take it out of the anonymous and bring it into the public sphere. Right? Thank you. Fred needs
it. Mr. Duggar, then we are going to vote.
Mr. Cannon, I haven't spoken on this issue yet.
So you didn't have your hand up.
I do not.
Well, let Mr. Duggar.
Shall I stand down?
No.
I would just point of clarification again, Dana Duggar. I would suggest a careful reading of Act 359, Section 42.6. Because a lot of the discussion and proposals are outlined in state law. The township does not, according to my layman's reading, does not have the statute to amend the state law to change the way Act 359 works, and that it, a careful reading and careful study of this act and a lot of the nuances of how they meet, and that it is open meetings, and how this works. It's all spelled out in Act 359, and it is an open and transparent process according to the Act. And I would just, again, strongly encourage the rereading of Act 359 to have a better understanding, both from the board and folks. Research your available. It's quite readily available. Just Google mm-hmm. MCL 359, 1947. You get the whole thing. Comes up in a second. And educate yourself. We need to be educated citizens, educated mm-hmm. voters, and educated board members. Thank you again.
Thank you. Mr. Gillham has the floor.
Thank you. I want to see if I can take some of the extraneous issues out of this. There's two ways to set the compensation for elected officials. One, make them vote on what their pay is. Or two, set up a compensation commission, let the compensation commission decide. And then if you do that, the compensation commission recommendation automatically goes into effect unless you deny it with a two-thirds vote. Mm-hmm. The resolution that is introduced here by Mr. Keyes is to eliminate the compensation commission that was created by ordinance. That's it. It's the only issue. Now, by ordinance, it's a two-step process. You introduce this, then you vote if you want to pass an ordinance that repeals a previous ordinance. This will repeal at the next meeting, the second step of the process, whether we have a compensation commission or not, whether we repeal the compensation commission and make the elected officials set their own pay. Now, there's a couple ways to do that. One, you could do a resolution that says, here's the pay of the elected officials, and it's automatic that this is what happens. Or you could do a resolution that says it goes into an effect at the start of the next term. So whoever's elected gets the opportunity to say that will be the pay of the next person that the voters choose to put in that position. Simple as that. That's what we're talking about here. Since my name was mentioned from a previous elected position that I had, I served on the County Board of Commissioners. I served in 2009 and 10 as the chair of that body. When I was the chair of that body, it was the wake of a global economic crisis where revenue was literally falling through the floor. And as the chair, I had to go and I had to ask all of our employees for concessions to say, we can no longer maintain the workforce that we have. We can no longer maintain to pay you at the rate that we pay. And if we do, we're gonna have to lay off some of your coworkers. So what I did is I said, if we're asking for concessions from the employees, then we should lead by example. And we should take the hit first. So before we went to the bargaining table with the employees, we imposed the starting position on the commissioners. We imposed that pay cut. I think it was like a 6%. Then we went to the unions that represented those employees and negotiated, and they all took less of a cut. But since that's what I was asking for, I imposed it on myself and all of the other commissioners. That's leadership. That's what we have to do here. Set the pay, and I supported this because I believe it's important that one, the pay is adequate, the pay is fair for whoever you decide to elect. I will say that right now, my pay is dramatically less than people I supervise. I think Ms. Meltzer mentioned that as well. So, will there be a resolution? There may be. Any one of us can introduce it. Anybody can bring it forward and say, hey, I think this is what the pay should be. Then, once it's introduced, we have to vote on it, and you all then get to decide, do we think it's fair or do we not? And then you get to hold us accountable based upon that. That's what is possible. Anybody can do it. And then you all know, and it's done with the ultimate level of transparency. So I'm supporting this.
Just one more comment. I do want to remind, maybe some of you here in the audience, were not here in the audience at the last meeting. Maybe it was a previous, that was the last meeting, because it's been so long since we've had meetings. normally we meet every 2 weeks. But we dissolved a service, a chipper service for a lot of residents And now we're turning around and talking about increasing our wages?
No, we're not.
I find that really contradicting, and I find it not to be leadership. And I agree, you know, we are underpaid, but again, a lot of our residents are underpaid. And we're the leaders, we're the servants, we are the ones that should lead by example. And I think the introduction of this ordinance to politicize elected officials' pay and give them raises is wrong.
Thank you, sir. And then we are going to vote. We do have a motion and support on the floor. You're the last speaker.
This is actually why I came, and you'll have to forgive me. I'm not great at speaking in this format. I'm actually going to be running for an office coming up here, not locally, because I've talked about you and I like most of you. But I just want to say, it should be public, but the infighting between you guys, like, it does not look good. I mean, I like all of you. I've never spoken with you personally, but the other four I have. It's disappointing. I mean, it's very politicized, and maybe we should be talking about it in a more open format. I really like you, help me out all the time, and you too. We should be talking about a more open format, though. Maybe the accountability should be here, because the fighting, this is such a hot button topic. It makes me concerned why. It really, really does. I mean, the infighting, it's just not professional. I don't like it. Maybe I should be running for local. Like, maybe. So maybe everybody should. I'm a big believer in that. Everybody should go. There should be 30 people's names on the ballot. It's just disappointing. It's, you know, I respect you all, but I just want to let you know.
Thank you. We have a motion on the floor and a support. Roll call, please.
Trustee Keys.
Yes.
Treasurer Gillingham.
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon.
No.
Trustee Kress.
No.
Clerk Meltzer, no. Motion fails.
Thank you. Item three, update fee schedule.
So, Mr. Cannon, this was only brought to, just recently brought to the attention. A lot of, as this is, tis the season for solicitation, of commercial solicitation, where companies come into the township and try to sell things. Well, we have to license that. And one thing we noticed was on our application and what's in our ordinance, our fee schedule was different. So this is just bringing that. It's not raising any fees. This is what we have on our application. It's just cleaning up the language and making sure that our ordinance and our well, it's not an ordinance, actually now a fee schedule. But it's making sure our fee schedule and our applications are the same. So what this does is it brings forward it's a resolution revising Clinton Township Code of Ordinance, Chapter 209, General Fee Schedule, amending license fees for transient merchants, peddlers, outdoor shopkeepers, and distributors. So the basic fee is $175 for the initial principal of the company, and then $125 per employee. And we do background checks on all of them. Our police do. We're very strict on having them in our community. But just as an I just want to bring this up as well, but this has nothing to do with the ordinance. But when you do see a solicitor at your front door and you decide to open the door, first of all, be very discretionary in doing so. But if you do decide to open that door, they have to, they're required by our ordinance, to have their credentials displayed. And so that's very important. And if they tell you, sorry, because I've had them come to my door, and here I'm the clerk, they go, oh no, and I already know they're not licensed because we do the licensing. So I go, where's your credentials? Oh, it's in the car. So you have to have it on. When I already know it's not in there. And I said, so when you go get your credentials, then you can come back. But I know for a fact, and then I'll report them to the police because this company is in our community illegally. But I want you to be aware that you have legal standing to tell somebody, you know, you're not here legally. You cannot be here without the credentials, even if they're in your car, which is wrong. That's a lie, generally. So this ordinance, all this is cleaning up the fee schedule and making sure it aligns with our application. So any questions on that? I'll take.
Did you have a comment or question?
I would like to comment. If you're
yes.
Right, it's the time.
This is the time.
Fred Neenstead, 41362 Justin Drive. The schedule applies to, let's call them peddlers. Would that be door-to-door canvassers? But I do a lot of door-to-door canvassing when I'm trying to get a candidate elected. Do I have to pay a fee?
No. This is covered by, Mr. Cannon? This is that activity would be covered by the First Amendment, your right to, and we don't license that at all. So even nonprofit organizations, church organizations, none of them, and that includes political entities, have to get licensed with the township.
Right. So if an individual is in a public area and exchanging political bumper stickers for money, is that covered under this?
That would, again, be, I mean, if there's an exchange, it might be considered a commercial. If you'd like, I can ask our attorney. I wish I could right now, but they're not here. But I can find that out for you, Mr.
I would sincerely like the attorney to comment publicly on a Supreme Court decision that allows for a religious freedom of speech in the public arena, and that it could possibly apply also to political free First Amendment speech in the public arena. So solicitation of contributions for a church activity is covered and protected by First Amendment. There's court case, and can't cite it myself right now, but I believe I'll be able to get that to you at your convenience. Thank you.
Fred, what you need to do is, and you won't have time right now because we're coming up to it, is fill out a public comment card, and then our attorney would respond to that. No, sir, you had your opportunity.
I was going to respond.
Something new?
This issue hasn't even been discussed yet,
okay.
Other than its introduction.
Okay.
So, yes.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Cannon. So what is the current fee for a transient merchant, peddler, outdoor shopkeeper, and distributor?
It's $175 and $125 on our application.
Okay,
but on the ordinance.
And this would change it to what?
$175 to $125. On the ordinance, I believe, as it says right now, do you have the fee schedule pulled up?
No, I have the only thing that was placed into the agenda that was presented to us.
Pull up the fee schedule on our, here, I'll pull it up for you. I can pull it up for you. That's no problem.
Okay, and then my second question is, because this is part of the fee schedule, this is a one vote, not a two vote, right?
No. So we changed our fee schedule, not that I expect you to remember every little thing, and I wouldn't accuse you of not knowing and that not being transparent, but we did, as a board, change the fee schedule from an ordinance, separated that out from ordinances so that when cases like this come up, it doesn't have to be a two-step process. It's just fixing. So this is actually, once we approve this is a resolution, it goes into effect right away.
Okay, so the answer is yes. This is a one vote rather than a two vote because it's a resolution, not an ordinance.
Yeah.
I appreciate the answer to that question.
Sure.
The second, or rather the other question is, why was this added to the special board meeting agenda when everyone just got done arguing that none of these things, even though the previous item was a two vote, and so it's just a public hearing, why was this added to this agenda that was so pure and pristine prior to, one of the board members monkeying it up? Why was it added?
Well, because as I stated in the very beginning, this is the season for solicitation, and so we wanted to get this in line as quickly as possible. Yes, we could have waited another week, but it just so happens there was a solicitor that sent in a question asking us, what is the process? And that's when I looked at it, and I'm like, this isn't quite right. So I contacted our attorney. He said, yes, we can go ahead and update the fee schedule. And so we want to be prepared for legitimate businesses in our community, the sooner the better. So this takes care of that a week early.
Okay, so let's go back to then just my first question, which is, what is the fee now?
I'm trying
to. What are we proposing it to be?
Hang on 1 second.
Well, she gave you that part.
No, she did not give me that part, Mr. Cannon.
Hang on 1 second.
She said she was looking it up, and she's still looking it up.
The part that she's saying is $175 and $125.
So, Mr. Cannon,
catch up.
There's $175 basic fee and then a $125 per employee.
Right now,
what it is being changed to, I want to know what it currently is in those two categories.
Yeah, it's $150 right now and $100. So it is going up. So it's from $150.
So it's going $25. bucks on both.
25.
The basic fee and the per employee.
Yep.
Okay,
it's
thank you.
Yeah.
Sir, you have the floor.
Oh, no, I'll clarify with him later.
Dana?
Yeah, just another quick point on 359. I did research about your special meeting, and I found what prompted me to come here today is that according to Act 359, you can change from a special meeting to a general meeting at the discretion of the board. So items could be added, all amended. You are not locked in to what you can do at a special meeting. So there is discretion. Again, reading Act 359 would be great.
Mr. Ken, I can clarify. That's true, but only if there's an entire board. And then the board would vote on it. But clearly, there's not an entire board today, so we couldn't change it from a special meeting, which would allow. So whatever is noticed, that's what we can discuss when there's not an entire board present during a special meeting, just for clarification.
Thank you. Further comments? The floor is open for a motion.
So moved.
Is there a second? Second. Roll call, please.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Trustee Keyes?
Yes.
Trustee Kress?
Yes.
Treasurer Gilliham?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Okay, we have three public comments this evening. John Grossenbacher?
I already addressed the stuff.
He's already addressed it. Thank you. Sam Bichelle?
Per the FOIA coordinator, Township Attorney Dolan's response to my FOIA request on what the planning director administrator could approve on the old Hague Lighting Facility at the corner of Grossbeck and Kelly Roads, Mr. Dolan seems to have been misinformed on what was done at the Hague property. As noted in my email to each of you, there is clear evidence of much more than a facade change in this property. The aerial survey maps, which the township has and the county has, show the building has been extended into the front yard setback with covers over the new doors. Homes have been forced to go to the ZBA very recently at great expense to themselves to put the same sort of covers over their porches. The brand new parking lot and entrances go well into the setback requirements on both Grossbeck and Kelly Roads. This would need ZBA variance approval. The planning director, as noted per my email to each of you, noted the parking lot was just a grass at the planning commission meeting. This is on video. Nobody has to take my word for it. He thought it was very funny, and some of the planning commissioners did too, because there was never a parking lot there. The extension of the dumpster enclosure, while a plus, was not on a part of the building. It also is an extension of the building, not a new thing. The new lighting in the new parking lot is another addition. It's never been there. Gonna have some light poles there. We have no idea. We got somebody in a back room that's able to approve that. Will we taxpayers, through the Kelly Road paving project, pay for the two new approaches already dug out that were never there in the past? Both the aerial survey maps and the video taken as part of the Kelly paving project prove nothing was there in the past, ever. Chapter 1297, development approval procedure, which I've got right here, which the planning, the attorney sent, makes it clear that the procedure provided Mr. Dolan as part of my FOIA request makes clear that the administrator does not have the authority to grant variances, such as the many needed on the Hague property. There again, very clearly, this same chapter makes very clear that the non-conforming use at the Goo Warehouse distributorship, wholesale distributorship in the B2 local business district required township board approval. Not even the planning commission can approve that. And it's right here on the form. There again, people hold up their paperwork. I've got the paperwork right here from the ordinance sent by the attorney, and I've got the attorney's letter right here. With all of this clear evidence, the board must take immediate action to rein in the illegal actions by any employee of the township approving, facilitating sites in the township not brought through the required legal ordinances. These ordinances are required for the health, safety, and welfare of the citizens you work for. In the case of Goo, it led to the death and destruction of the area. I know Mr. Dolan has stated in the past that the board, he's the board's attorney, not us citizens. I would hope that your attorney would have our best interest at heart also. Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, we don't respond.
Oh, no, no, just have a question.
Okay.
Can I ask you? The absence of the attorney today, will that be reflected in their billing? Or do we have to make a motion for that? Or
no,
I'm very disappointed that there's not an attorney present.
This board majority voted to give the current attorney basically $1,000 a day, whether it's a Sunday, holiday.
So the fact that they're not in attendance and helping us, they're still going to get $1,000 a day.
Correct. Right,
thank you.
No, I have a question.
Fred, we have...
I have a question.
No, this is public comment. Fred?
You just allowed a question.
He's a new member.
About our attorney, who's not here. Fred?
Yeah, I have a question about our attorney as well, Mr. Kim.
Thank you, Supervisor, Board. So I recently was driving on Garfield, but Fred Neenstead, 41362 Justin Drive. On Garfield, there is a business that has a banner that on the face of it driving by gave me the impression that there was the opportunity for some marijuana products. Is that possible in this township right now? Mm-hmm. Are they allowed to sell? Mm-hmm. Can they represent for sale? Is this a violation similar?
This is not a question and answer.
Right, right. I understand. So I'm pointing it out. And again, I did not do any investigation. I don't feel it's my responsibility to challenge a proprietor. Don't feel like making a public complaint to the police right now. Looking for information. Hopefully you can comment later. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. G, is it a quick question?
Yeah, I want to know if anybody called the attorneys to say, hey, there's a special meeting at this time.
I did.
And we really want you to be at the board meeting.
I did.
The answer is
okay.
Yes.
Yes.
All right, and
yes,
you've got an email to that effect?
Not an email. You just said you wanted to know if anybody called.
Called
I
or contacted?
I did call. I didn't ask for an email. I didn't put an email. I said, are you attending? And Jack Dolan said, no, he is not attending, but Linda McGrail would be there. And I said, okay, great.
So we were expecting someone.
All right, so you were expecting somebody. That's all.
Yeah.
Simple
yeah.
question.
Yeah.
Motion to adjourn is in order.
So moved.
Support. Roll call, please.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Treasurer Gilliam.
Yes.
Trustee Keyes?
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Trustee Kress?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Fred, I can answer that question.